Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for that really, really lovely introduction. First of all, I wanted to, before I speak anywhere, I just wanted to recognize the land that we're standing on and we're in use of as occupied territory. So I just wanted to take a minute to recognize Native American tribes that were here way before we were. I also wanted to say that as a precursor to some of the things that I talk about, it could intersect on violence within sport and with misogyny. So if anybody needs to take a minute to talk about things like that, because some of the conversation topics could be about race, could be about something, take a minute to check in with yourself, breathe if you need to leave. I totally get it. So just wanted to let you know that. I'm really excited to be here. I do also really want to thank Dr. Stege and Dr. Abujayar for inviting me here. I come from a family of basketball players, so they completely freaked out when I told them I was coming to Villanova. Really big deal. My son's like, get me a t-shirt. I was like, okay. So I am very, very grateful for the opportunity to speak to you about those meeting points of intersectional feminism and sports. As mentioned, I'm a freelance writer and a sports activist. I have a good family, but most importantly, I have two cats. And their names are Sithara and Zaytun, and I'm happy to show you pictures of them afterwards. I'm totally not kidding. Just moving on, it is an honor for me to be here and to speak to you about two things I'm very passionate about Muslim women and sports. So you begin to wonder, how does my experience as a Muslim sports writer, how and what does it affect the way in which I write? So there have been discussions in the news lately about objectivity. I don't know if anyone following any editorials and the reporting being done has been talking about objectivity. And there have been instances raised where the argument is, well, if you're too connected to an issue, then you won't be able to report accurately or fairly on it. I am of the opinion that objectivity as such is a social construct, and it is of the white privileged elite that run the media industry to begin with. So I reject that notion. So I feel like people in my position that come from marginalized communities and different communities, their perspectives are enhanced, and it provides a different lens with which to look at a subject and a different approach, perhaps sometimes. And although I do research, and is this not working? Okay, no worries. Am I moving too much?
No, it should be fine.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
No worries. So I research and write, and I connect with women all over the world, because truthfully, the Muslim women in sports niche is really not a big one. So I know, shocking. So my thoughts are generally focused on media from the global north, because as mentioned, I live and I work in Canada. So Muslim women are often written of as topics of interest, and most recently we saw this in the Rio 2016 Olympics. The subject of clothing came up incessantly. Everyone's favorite topic with regards to Muslim women is clothing. I'll rant on that a little more later. And just to mention something Dr. Stege said, if you do follow me on Twitter, I apologize profusely because I'm constantly ranting. My children have blocked me. They unblock me just to say, like, happy birthday or whatever. But if you, I like Twitter a lot. Anyway, I digress. So there's a few things that we need to understand as we move forward about why the subject of incessantly tokenizing women to hijab is problematic. And there's a few things that we can learn from this. Muslim women in sport deserve to be told in a manner that's befitting of their skill and their position. So there's a few things. First, clothing restrictions affect participation levels. And this is really important. Head covering bans, and I'll go a little bit into this, by FIBA have currently not been lifted fully, and by the Boxing Association, the AIBA, they actually influence how many competitors attend international tournaments and represent nations. So there is often criticism at major tournaments, just such as the Olympics, mega events, where you see contingents from countries coming, but you don't see very many women. Now, although this is a fair critique, people don't realize that the participation levels is directly correlated to whether they can actually wear what they want to when they're competing. So if you don't see women, many from, it might just be that for the particular sport, they're not permitted to participate or play or compete in what they want to. The other thing is there's a significant amount of reporting without actually any geopolitical understanding of places in the Muslim majority world. And I read an article, I think it was like 3 months ago, and I'm a believer in naming and shaming, so if I find out, I can't remember the author's name, but they were basically criticizing the Iraqi Football Federation for not supporting the women's league as or national team. But the problem is the women's training facility was actually destroyed by ISIS. So there's nowhere for them to actually practice. And I'm sorry, but recovering from PTSD, displacement and the horrors of war might cut into soccer practice. So I think it's really important to keep that in mind when we're looking in the nuanced perspective at something. Of course, I tweeted angrily at the author and got no reply, but I'll go back and find out their name just to point it out, because it was a rejection of my criticism completely. Because there's a way to go at something and say, well, we want to amplify women and we want to amplify their position, but it's really important to do this in a manner that's understanding where they are. Lastly, before I move on, I've done a little prezi to sort of illustrate some of what I'm talking about. The discussion of clothing actually others athletes and ignores pressing issues that Muslim women in sports actually face would be lack of funding, social support, stadium bans, forced covering, abuse of power by federations, internal misogyny. Like, these are real issues. So we're going to take a look at a few things, and then we can talk about histories, or as I prefer to say, her stories of Muslim women in sports. So when I started writing, I noticed a trend in the way that Muslim women were written of. And I say this because there's not a tremendous amount of Muslim women or women of color writing. By the way, if anyone is interested, I have an amazing doc that I'm happy to share about women of color sports writers. And if you're not following at least five of them, start following women of color sports writers. So I will be happy to share that document with anybody. Okay, so what I did was I created a bingo card. So Muslim women in sports bingo. And because, oh, I can use my pointer now. So the first mention, anytime you see anything about a Muslim woman in sports, they talk about what she's wearing. Because it's absolutely essential to her jab, if she's a boxer, that she's wearing a headscarf. Y'all have to know this, right? They use words like liberated, free, breaking barriers, cycle of oppression. So they could be in Virginia in a boxing ring, but they're still breaking free of the cycles of oppression that's around them. You're supposed to laugh there. That was a joke. Okay. Expressing awe and delight that a Muslim or Muslimah is familiar with sports to begin with. When I tell people I'm a sports writer, they get stressed out because I don't look like a sports writer. And then there's this is just my experience, I only speak for myself. That's so great that you like sports. You like hockey. Hello, I'm Canadian. Obviously, I like hockey. There'll always be, even if it's not correlated to anything to do with that athlete and their sport, there will be a mention. Somebody will find some uncle in a masjid that has a problem with this, and they'll write it down in this article. Some uncle or someone in the community will give a negative comment, and the journalist will feel compelled to share that as part of the larger story. No. This is free for whatever. Then there'll always be commentary on how the father or brother or male in the family feels about it. I certainly don't refer to my husband or father or son or brother if I need to go to a soccer game, but whatever, maybe that's not relevant. There's very, very limited advertising for Muslim women in certain spaces. There's always a mention, always a mention of violence against women in that community. I remember reading an article about a cross-country skier in Oregon, really, really interesting. And for some reason, the author of the article decided to mention female genital mutilation in the story and how it was common in Muslim communities. I mean, she's cross-country skiing in Oregon. I didn't figure that out. I still haven't figured it out, actually. And in this particular instance, I was too tired, just exhausted by this, to actually tweet the author and tell them they were ridiculous. So mention to me, follow up on that one. There's always a mention of country of origin, immigration status, because, you know, you can't just be American, can't just be Canadian. You're going to be from somewhere. Like this particular person who's maybe second or third generation, their forefathers came from some village somewhere, because that's always really relevant. I don't know. So that's where this came from. And I wrote it as out of frustration. It came out of frustration. And then I was mortified at how actually accurate it was. So if you ever want to play, have fun, you can do this. So one of the ways that we can move directly from the bingo, okay, let's talk about, I'm complaining a lot, but who's actually writing about Muslim women in sports? I was very honored very recently, She Source Media, recognized me as one of their experts, She Source experts. So Women's Media Center is a huge organization out of New York, and these statistics actually come from one of their studies. Now this is basically telling us, and these aren't statistics I'm making up, the Women's Media Center has said that in the United States, and the statistics are slightly higher in Canada, sports media is often 90% white, able-bodied, cisgendered men. So this is not a shock to anybody, but just when you hear that, 90, right? So it's a lot, and in Canada, I would actually venture to say it's 95. So that's why I like to call myself Sriracha in a mayonnaise factory. So you can laugh there too. So how does this actually affect the perception of Muslim women? A lot, because words matter. Words matter a lot. Now, I am also a writer. I realize that the leads and the headers are not the fault of the author. I get that. But let's look at how ridiculous this is. First of all, oh, no, wait, hang on. So up on the left, this was a photo you all might have seen in the Rio Olympics, because it was a really big deal that the first time in the history of beach volleyball that the FIVB, the International Federation of Volleyball, sanctioned wearing full covering, which was amazing, yes. But a lot of people don't realize that it was the first time that they stopped sanctioning women's swimsuits altogether. In my research, I actually found out that that federation had actually mandated what women wear to the amount of centimeters of the bikini bottom. So we're not talking about just restricting and policing what Muslim women are wearing. They're policing bodies generally. Unless you could argue you had a skin issue or a sun allergy. I don't know why you'd be playing beach volleyball if you had a sun allergy, but I'm not judging, I'm just saying. You could wear a rash guard, but you had to lobby through your federation to get that permission. So down to the centimeters, that's how much beach volleyball female players, their uniforms were mandated by the federation. So what I really love is bikini versus burqa. First of all, she's not actually wearing a burqa. She's wearing a sports hijab and a rash guard. And if any of you surf, you know this. So not a whole lot of research and intelligence went into creating this lead. Also, it pits woman against woman. Can't it just be Germany playing Egypt? Does it have to be a clash of civilizations? Next one. Chuck Culpepper at the Washington Post, because if you're going to write a series on Muslim women, you'll ask Chuck Culpepper, right? No offense if anyone's related to him in this room. I'm just saying the way in which the story was presented was extremely reductive, because the Middle East women were once discouraged from sport. I'm going to get into that later because that's factually incorrect. You cannot use an entire brushstroke and generalize an entire society that has a history, a rich history of sport and recreation of women, because you feel like it and you work for the Washington Post. And I'm not salty because I didn't get this gig. That's not what this is about. I'm serious. So what do we learn from this? Continued objectification and assumptions here. So there's some narratives that come to play. Muslim women are featured as fighters and challenging the norm. It's like if Taj Muhammad could walk down the street, people are like, whoa, what an empowered Muslim woman. She's walking down the street. Everybody calm down, okay? Muslim women, just by existing, can't have the burden of crashing misogyny in their societies and breaking the chains of patriarchal Islam. No, okay? I'm not smashing any assumptions. I'm just giving you my prezi. Do you know what I'm saying? Yeah, okay. So immediate sometimes it happens that female athletes generally, be they LGBTIQ, with disabilities, Paralympians, whatever, para-athletes, they become spokespeople and activists if they choose to. So this happens a lot with Muslim women. They get questions, like the questions in a media scrum at Olympics or an international venue is very different depending on where the athletes are from. Athletes, I was at one, and the questions from the women in the South American countries, the Women's World Cup held in Canada, was very different. It was, how does your society feel about you? Whereas the American team, nobody asked how society felt about them. And it's not to say that misogyny and sexism aren't rampant and aren't being faced by the U.S. national women's team, who are world champions and still not paid equally. So I think that's really interesting, because it's easy for people to sit back and point at the foreign countries and say, well, you got problems there. Well, you have lawsuits against you two here. I'm just saying, right? And to be fair, same thing happened in Canada. I'm not just saying that, oh, Canada's better than everyone else. I did not say that, for the record, okay? So the stories of Muslim women in hijab tend to be fetishized significantly. And this is important. There's, yes, hijab fetishization happens. And we have to keep in mind, too, that the vast majority of Muslim women in the world do not wear hijab. So what ends up happening is there's an erasure of their existence and their histories and their contributions. So sports ends up taking a backseat here. It becomes all about the uniform, the clothing, and it's less about the actual athlete. So what do we do here? The first and foremost thing we're going to do is we are going to diversify our hiring practices, which would be non-brainer, you would think, because 90% of people writing about sports are white dudes, okay? And all respect to those that have contributed and write amazing things and do it nuanced. And in no way am I saying that if you're a white dude, you can't write about Muslim women or women of color or para-Olympians. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying do it in a responsible manner. Put a little bit more effort into it. Know your research. Know what you're talking about. The other thing, amplify Muslim women themselves. Like, the best person to actually talk about Ibtihaj Muhammad, who I'm assuming everybody knows because she's like a hero, a shiro, is Ibtihaj Muhammad. She's been published in Time. She's been, interviews with her are incredible. She's like all over the place. She can, and not everybody, keep in mind, chooses to do this or has the ability or want or interest to articulate, but she does. And she can give you so much insight into her journey by listening to her. But women in sports are most often spoken of as opposed to speaking up themselves. Not because they can't, because they're not often given platforms. So next thing, read Muslim women, because they are out there, and their stories are interesting. Muslim women generally are not a monolith. I only speak for myself and my experiences, and if I'm trusted with stories of other people, I try to tell them responsibly. But some of the most fascinating writing I've ever read is different communities. Queer Muslims, Muslims with disabilities, Muslims from different communities, different sects of Islam. Everybody has a different perspective. I'd encourage you to try to diversify because, you know, it's really important to get a nuanced perspective. And so we're going to reject and refute Orientalist viewpoints. And I had a star to tell you a story, and I can't remember now what that star was for and what story it was. But it was important and relevant, and I, for the life of me, cannot remember. What was it? Maybe I'll remember somewhere down the line. Oh, actually, maybe I wrote it down. So, what? No, I totally can't remember. Okay, so what we're going to do, wait, no, I do remember. Sorry, I'm going to go back there because I do remember. Orientalist viewpoints. I wrote a piece. I was really upset. How many of you have ever heard of Skateistan in Afghanistan? It's a super, super cool program. Now, Afghanistan is a very traditional culture and conservative culture, and they have set ideas about what footballers or soccer players look like and what cricketers look like. They look like men. They had no preconceived notions of what a skateboarder would look like because the sport actually didn't exist in their country. So along comes really, really cool guy from Germany, and he starts a foundation called Skateistan. This is a way to keep young women in school by using sport as a vehicle, skateboarding. Now, because it had never been in Afghanistan, there was no people to say, that's not okay for girls, because nobody had done it. It was brilliant. It took off. It expanded to Herat. It expanded to different places in Afghanistan. It expanded to Cambodia. It's now in South Africa. It's a project and a model that works. It's amazing. Now, I've written about Skatistan. I totally fangirl over them. You should really check them out. Super cool. The pictures are amazing. So as I'm going through some stories and whatnot, I see a header of a story, say, Skatistan, the success story in a land where sports are forbidden and women can't ride a bicycle. Okay, let's hold up. Let's hold up for a minute. And I know because that's not true. Because I'm actually writing a piece with Shannon Galperin, who's the mountain cyclist from Oregon, who coached the national cycling team of Afghanistan. So we're going to big up one thing and then say, oh, this doesn't exist at all. Yes, in certain places in Afghanistan, women don't ride bicycles. But to say it completely erases the work of the women and the training that they're doing. Yes, Afghan Cycles is also something I would suggest everybody check out because they were nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize for their project. It really, all it takes is Google. It's really not that difficult to find this stuff. And I thought it was incredibly responsible to paint an entire, on one hand, of rising up one project, which is absolutely successful, to tear down another one. And so that's what that asterisk was for. So I got upset and again tweeted angrily at somebody. Nothing really came of it other than just me being shouty, which is fine. Okay, so I'm going to include this because I love Louisa Nassib so much, and I just try to put her in my slideshows when I can. She's a French soccer player of Algerian descent. I love her. She retired this year, and I cried, but that's okay. She speaks about her. She left soccer because she wanted to pursue a family. Now, what happened in France, and you know how French media loves Muslims. That's a joke. There was an absolute cut to her and her choice. She made a choice. I think it would be really responsible and, I don't know, fair if we supported that choice. She wants to have a family. She married a soccer player and felt that she wanted to do this. Maybe after she has kids, she could go back to it. But the lack of support and the criticism she got immediately from French press was it was blaming her heritage for that choice, that she stuck at home. And her husband has gone on record repeatedly to say it was her choice. I don't know if anybody knows or has heard of Bilqis Abdul Qadir. I spelled Abdul wrong. Shelby, don't tell her that. Bilqis is amazing. Bilqis is actually, to this day, the highest scoring high school student from the state of Massachusetts. She played Div 1 Memphis, and she is awesome. She is also not allowed to play professionally, even though she was drafted to Europe, because she wears a headscarf. So there is a head covering ban on in FIBA, which is the federation that governs basketball. FIFA, the Federation of Football, Soccer, lifted their ban formally in 2012. And they had a really strategized plan. I'm not one to get up here and be like, oh, FIFA's so amazing. They're a cesspool of misogyny and fraud and corruption. But the one thing they got right was how to carry this out properly. And they did it because it was women on the committee that were really invested in changing this policy. The headscarf ban does not only apply to Muslim women, it applies to Sikh men who wear turbans and Jewish men who wear kippahs. So there's various communities that are affected by this, and I think that's important to note. And Bilqis joined up with another American, a Bosnian-American woman named Indira Kalyo, and they partnered up with some basketball players in India and started, end head covering ban was one of the hashtags. The other one was FIFA allow hijab. A couple weeks ago, because I just wrote about this for The Guardian, FIBA, although the legwork had already been done by FIFA, it's really not that difficult to just say, okay, well, there's actually no evidence whatsoever that wearing a headscarf or a turban during basketball can cause injury to you or to somebody else. And I don't know how many of you will be surprised to know that who do you think makes the decisions regulating sportswear for women? It's not women. It's not Muslim women, it's men with power and privilege in a boardroom. So how many of you think they actually had a conversation with a Muslim woman before implementing this ban? Yeah, I better not see hands up because it was none. So that sucked. Okay, moving on from this, this is just what I wanted to show you. People have this is what Muslim sportswomen look like. These are some friends of mine. The one on the end is Hajra Khan. She is the captain of the Pakistan women's football team. They're all Muslim women. One is covered. She chooses to cover. The rest don't. So they don't all look the same. And I think this is just proving my point. And like, it's important to recognize that in different places they have choice to wear. And I think that's what we should be supporting ultimately. The one in the shorts very tragically died in a car accident 6 months ago. Her name was Shailila Baloch, and she was her starting striker. And it was really devastating. So the team did not go to the South Asian Football Federation tournament because of a lot of things, including turmoil within the federation that's supposed to be advocating for them, but also because they had just recently lost one of their teammates. So this is really fun. This is Rand Albastanji, and this is important because Rand was one of the two women that first wore hijab after the ban was lifted at an international tournament. This tournament just happened in Jordan in November. It's the under-17 Women's World Cup. Now, Jordan participated in that and got a bye because they were the hosting nation. Otherwise, I'm not 100% sure they would have qualified yet, because don't forget, they were just allowed to wear hijab less than 2 years ago. But this is important for me, and also because my kid wears hijab and is a goalkeeper. So I'm kind of like, do this, because I'd love to get some free FIFA swag. This is also a Muslim woman in Turkey. This is Neslihan Darnal, who is a Turkish volleyball player. So when people think Muslim woman, they're not going to necessarily think that she looks like that. She does. Lots do. What else? This is Insha Asfar. She's amazing. She's a Paralympian ski. She lost one of her legs in an earthquake in Pakistan in 2007 in the northern part of Pakistan. And she decided to start skiing. So she did. And this is also what a Muslim athlete looks like. This is really fun, and I put it in just because I just think it's hysterically funny. And I try to also include it in my slideshows, just because I love it so much. I don't know if anyone's familiar with Marjan Satrapi. She's a graphic artist. This is from Persepolis, and I love this because this is how people get up in your business all the time. And this is really easy. I've actually personally encountered spaces in Muslim spaces where people are like, oh, well, young Muslim girls are running around, and it's not cool. So I went to my local imam, and I said, I need the space to coach a soccer team. I coach a middle school Muslim girls team. And I said, they're complaining that they're running around and whatever. And do you know what the imam said to me? He said, tell them not to look. It was literally that easy. You have a problem with it? Don't involve yourself. And I just like it because I think it's hilarious. So I'm going to leave that there because this is a really fun segue into, I often use Iran as an example of a contradiction in many things when we talk about Muslim women in sport. And arguably, Iran actually has one of the most developed sports programs in the Middle East and North African region. And I would arguably say South Asia as well. I might even add that they have tremendous futsal, air gun, many others. They have surfing programs and leagues for the most consistent leagues for disabled women. They're sitting volleyball. I didn't even realize sitting volleyball was a thing. It's a thing. Is ranked one of the highest in the Asian Federation. But at the same time, women in Iran must cover if they're representing their country. It's not an option. It's non-negotiable, actually. They don't have a choice like other Muslim-majority countries. There's a misunderstanding, I talked about this, Malaysia, Egypt, Turkey, Tunisia, Pakistan, Kazakhstan, Muslim-majority countries, there's choice there to cover or not, while sports or otherwise. Iran and, to my knowledge, Saudi Arabia and Brunei are the other places that do not offer women that choice. But the comparison between Saudi, Iran, and Brunei is not a good one because Iran is light years ahead in terms of development of women's sport, light years ahead. Shireen Jarami is Iran's first triathlete, and she was also the first Iranian woman to compete in Ironman in Hawaii this past fall. There was huge features on her in Sports Illustrated. You might have seen a tweet fly by about just talking about how cool it was that there was a Muslim woman competing in the Ironman. And a special kit was created for her for swimming and then cycling and running. just going to digress for a minute and just add that she actually was not the first woman to wear hijab in the Iron Man, a black Muslim woman from Atlanta, Georgia, who was 48. Her name is Khadija Diggs. She was. But that's just to give you an idea of Khadija was less of an interesting story than Shireen Jahrami was. But if you dug a little deeper, you would realize that there are Muslim women doing this already. And sometimes information is selective in how it's widely shared. So there's a slew of other issues in Iran, and one of them I've actually written about and would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge it. It would be the stadium ban on women attending international tournaments within Iran. Currently, women cannot attend major sporting events in Iran, and it's incredibly discriminatory and goes against many of the charters that each sports federation actually claimed to uphold. Because many of them say sports is for everyone, men, women, regardless of their where they're from, should have access to this. And they don't uphold that. How can you if women aren't allowed in the stadium? This includes FIFA. It includes the Volleyball Federation. There's a small organization in Tehran that is called Open Stadiums. And they're on Twitter as well. Their activists are anonymous for safety reasons. And they've been working for years to reach out to federations because they're not getting any movement from within, externally to try to have international federations shift the change within the Iranian government. Now, one suggestion from people automatically who are less aware are like, boycott it, boycott everything, seems to be a knee-jerk reaction. If you actually listen to the people in Iran, that isn't the solution at all. Now, the activists that I've spoken with and interviewed insist that imploring international federations is actually far more effective. And allowing women in those spaces is crucial. And don't avoid dealing with it by simply sanctioning and boycotting them. That's not going to fix the problem. It's not going to address it at all. So the rule of law, the federations respond and say, well, we can't oppose the rule of law of the host nation, which is a bit cowardly, in my opinion, because there are ways to find solutions. Now, the reason very specifically is cringeworthy, and I'll tell you anyway because it's online, is it states that women in Iran would not be in a socially safe environment, meaning it's a little rowdy, you know, men get a bit upset in these environments because of sport and passion, and I mean, that could be construed as unsafe or dangerous for women. I don't know, but if anyone ever watches my mother watch the Montreal Canadiens, there's nothing less dangerous than that. So my point is women can handle it. Really, we can handle it. So, you know, the coarse language, we can handle whatever. Now, Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates also don't have a culture of women going to stadiums. But in the last 4 years, what they've done is create spaces within those stadiums, family spaces, so women have the privacy they need, they can enjoy the sport as well. It's really not that difficult to arrange this, to create a portion of the stadium for women. If you want that, or if women prefer that segregation, they can have it, or have family spaces. So, you know, this has been a successful model. And I find it really bizarre that Iranian women are so encouraged to play sports, but they can't actually sit in their own country and watch and cheer them on. It's incredible how that doesn't work. So what ends up happening is that women turn out in droves to watch Iran play overseas. And we saw this in Rio in 2014 in the FIFA World Cup. There were droves of Iranian fans coming from other places to watch Iran play. And it was pretty incredible. So this particular struggle was immortalized in Jafar Panahi's really awesome film. I encourage everybody to watch it. It's called Offside. And what it is, it's based on a true story, and it shows the struggle of young Iranian football fans have to dress up like boys to watch the matches and what happens. So it's really, really interesting. It's a great film. So as I mentioned, boycotting sports is not really an effective strategy. The Women's World Chess Championship is starting this weekend. It runs from February 10th to March 5th, and it's going to be held in Tehran, in Iran. And it will be the biggest women's sporting event in the history of that country. So there's an American chess player originally from Georgia, raised in Russia. Her name is Nazi Paikidze Barnes. So Barnes announced she would be boycotting the tournament because the expectation is that the female participants and players cover while they're there. So she declared, and I quote, "I think that it's unacceptable to host a women's world championship in a place where women do not have basic fundamental rights and are treated as second-class citizens." Okay, now the problem I have with this is that I'm unconvinced that Barnes actually ever spoke with an Iranian woman, which she didn't. Sadly, a common occurrence. But she actually said that wearing hijab, and also a quote, it would support oppression. There's definitely, definitely a space to have a conversation about allowing Muslim women to choose for themselves. And the freedom of choice is important, absolutely. But insisting that hijab supports oppression is misplaced, particularly from female players, when the female players from Iran were very public and said that they said a boycott would not be helpful for them. Remember them, the ones that are being oppressed? Funny how nobody listens to them. So Mitra Hijazipour is a grandmaster chess player from Iran, and she said, and I quote, "It's not right to call for a boycott. These games are important for women in Iran, and it's an opportunity for us to show strength. But I suppose when a white woman with little understanding of the complexity of the situation decides that Muslim women are oppressed, then we go with that, right?" It's important to note here as well that no other country in the world offered to host this tournament. Iran was the only one. And also, no other female participants complained about having to wear hijab while they were there. None of them did. The tournament's going to roll forward, and we'll see what happens. And there were, I mean, very recently, there have been reports of Iran rescinding visas of American athletes anyway in response to Trump's travel ban. So it would kind of render Barnes' actions moot if she was prevented from going in the first place. But let's see, neither here nor there. So moving on, Muslim countries actually provide opportunities for dual citizens to participate at high levels. Sara Atar is an American woman who was the first Saudi woman to represent, one of the first of two Saudi women to represent Saudi Arabia in the London Games. And she trains and lives in the United States. She's from California. She had the opportunity to attend the Games, and she took it. She doesn't cover regularly, but while she was representing Saudi Arabia, she wore a scarf. And she was fine with it, and she did it. So this brings us to another important point. The fixation and media biases towards Muslim women and hijab, which I did touch on. There's an erasure of Muslim women in sports who don't cover. I don't know how many of you have heard of Ibtihaj Muhammad. How many of you heard of Ibtihaj? Show of hands. Okay, Ibtihaj Muhammad was the first American woman to wear a headscarf and compete representing the United States. She's a fencer, a bronze medalist. Now, Dalia Muhammad, how many of you have heard of her? Okay. You guys got to keep up with your American sports team, seriously. Dalia Muhammad won a gold medal in the 400-meter hurdles. But it was Ibtihaj Muhammad, the one who wears a scarf, they're not related, by the way, that was plastered all over the place, not Dalia Muhammad. Dalia Muhammad is also a very strong, incredibly accomplished black Muslim woman. And I'm not reducing Ibtihaj Muhammad's accomplishments at all, particularly not in a time when this political rhetoric was really, really toxic. But the obsession about Muslim women's clothing does continue. And Dalia Muhammad was largely ignored. And according to a friend of mine who's an anthropologist at Cambridge University, her name is Sirtaj Siglikoglu, she told me, particularly in international media, there is a focus on Muslim athletes wearing hijab that has been to the detriment of non-hijab-wearing athletes, meaning lack of coverage. For example, there's a disproportionate focus on a Saudi woman named Mojadan Sherkhani, who was the first judoka to represent Saudi Arabia, even though she was only a blue belt and her dad trained her. But she still got, because the optics of a woman wearing hijab feed back into that stereotype that, oh, look, a veiled woman is doing something. So there's also the issue, and I'm almost wrapping up here, of media forgetting that Muslim women have actually existed in sports for a really long time. The first gold medal winner on record was a Moroccan runner named Nawal El Moutawakil, and she won gold in 84 in Los Angeles. So that's a pretty long time ago. For example, in 2012, Turkey, Muslim-majority country, sent more female athletes than they sent men. And Canada did that this year in Rio, and we got lots of press about how progressive we were. And it's also because our prime minister likes taking selfies and declared himself a feminist, but whatever. Now, one of the most interesting stories for me is the first Muslim woman on record to have ever competed at an international event was the Olympic Games, was a Turkish fencer named Halet Kembel, and she participated in the foil category. This was in Berlin in 1936. Now, her story is super cool because at the time, Berlin was like, oh, just a complete disaster with fascism and anti-Semitism. She had the option, and rumor has it that Halet was actually in the stadium when Jesse Owens won for 100-meter dash and Adolf Hitler lost a gasket and left in a rampage. He asked to meet Halet Kembel, and she refused very politely. She declined the invitation to meet him, stating she had political differences with him. There's no photo I could find of her, but she didn't cover. Well, she wore, well, she covered because she was a fencer, but not that she veiled outside of that. So I think that's really, there's some interesting historical things there. So a constant focus on representing Muslim women athletes by objectifying them as being a scarf continues. So there's definitely a way to advocate for the inclusion of Muslim women in sports without tokenizing that. But this will only happen by including Muslim women in those conversations about what affects them, be it policy, practice, reporting, and plans for the future. So I'm an advocate for Muslim women in sports. And what that means is I'll support them whether they choose to wear a burqa, a burkini, or a bikini. So that's all I have, folks. And I'm happy to take questions, comments. Nothing? Yes. Good question. It's probably a bit of both. Clickbait's huge. I mean, it's the internet. Like, they'll try to... I mean, I have...
I feel like everything is on the internet is clickbait. Like, it's all garbage.
Absolutely. But it's a matter of feeding through that. Because the problem is the optics of a Muslim woman is so politicized anyway that they wouldn't have done this to two white athletes. Do you know what I mean? Like, and that has to kind of have to recognize that. There's one thing I was going to add, if anyone's interested. There's two books that I would recommend, if anyone's interested at all. And maybe Hibba's mentioned them. There's a book called Do Muslim Women Really Need Saving? By Dr. Lila Abu-Loghod. She's a professor at Columbia University. And it's a fantastic book. And it basically talks about this notion of trying to save save Muslim women for whatever reason. And it's a great book to sort of give you an idea of a background of what I've been talking about, particularly the notion of having to be saved. Another one, and there's not, I am writing a book slowly. It's taking a really long time. I'll blame my kids. But there's another book by a woman named Dr. Hama Hoodfar, who's an Iranian academic. She's in McGill University. And it's called Women's Sports and Politics in Muslim Contexts. And it talks, it's basically an anthology of other people, academics mostly, that have studied and worked on cultural anthropology or sociology and the intersections of where politics meet Muslim society. So that's also a really interesting read. It's online, or maybe it's not online and I got an academic friend to send me a link. Is that bad? No? No? Okay. Anyway. So there would be some really cool places to start. If like you really like, where do I read about Muslim women? I'm happy to, you could have conversations with Ayan's back there. You could ask her. She'll tell you. The Dr. Lila Abu-Loghod book is really, really good. And I also love her because I wrote a review of it and she actually acknowledged it and wrote me back and I cried because it was amazing. So, yes. How did I get started on what?
As a sports person.
I got angry at the way people were writing about Muslim women, so I decided to do it myself because it was flaming garbage everywhere. And I mean, this isn't my first career. I have four kids, like I said. I have two cats, so important, those cats. I was also a counselor frontline at a settlement center working with refugees and women of color, and I stopped doing that. And then I was sort of really interested in the idea of using sports as a vehicle to empower women all over the world. I've done work with UWA, which is an incredible organization in India that uses soccer, and I'm a soccer player, so I still play badly, but yes, I'm in a granny league, that's okay. Using soccer, because soccer generally is a very inexpensive way to involve 22 people automatically. There's not a whole lot of equipment required, so it's a feasible model for people to use. It gets adrenaline pumping, it encourages teamwork and camaraderie, and people really need it, whether they're recovering from, you know, trauma or anything. So I really wanted to look at that, and then I started examining things around it. And I started off on a global, I was doing work with Girls and Women South Africa, which is a really interesting project close to Johannesburg in South Africa, and it's teaching women about reproductive rights and how to protect themselves against HIV and STIs. So that was just the way that people use sport in different places in the world. That really appealed to me. And then when I came back and was sort of like, let me look at North America. Oh, wow, there's nothing. And then I started writing and people were like, hey, this doesn't suck. So kind of, I mean, for a long time, I think I genuinely think it was just my mother reading my work, which is fine. But it's nice when, you know, you keep working a little more and people want to hear, like, are interested in what you have to say because it's a perspective they've never heard before. So if any of you want to be sports writers, I would really encourage you to do that, like, a lot. Oh, well, I mean, research in terms of how people tell me their stories. It's my experience that a lot of the time, people just aren't aware. And if you ask coaches, like in high schools or universities about it, they're usually willing to have that conversation. The reflex action sometimes can be no, because they don't know about it. But if you get into a conversation and have someone willing to talk to them about it or whatnot, it goes fairly smoothly. And it's really not a lot that you're asking. I know that there's one, there was a film about a football team in Michigan.
In Dearborn,
where I think 95% of the players were Muslim. And so they had their practices after sundown because everybody was fasting. So it worked for them. I mean, and to be really honest with you, Hakeem Olajuwon won the NBA championships while he was fasting. And people, you know, my husband's like, well, Hakeem did it. Yeah, well, I'm not Hakeem, okay? So I'm really lucky that if I have matches, it's usually sundown by halftime, so I'll take water and a date, and you rest up during the day. So the athletes already know this, but it's really nice to get support. Like if any of you have teammates or friends that are Muslim, like, hey, is there anything I can do? Because you can't really do someone. It's a personal thing to be fasting, but just to offer that support is always really nice. I mean, I had a friend make me banana bread with dates in it, and I woofed that down at halftime. So it was lovely that she, you know, thought of me. Do you have a question?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm curious what, if anything, you see as the intersection between these largely patronizing discourses about, Western discourses about Muslim women in sports and attempts to farther nationalize the agenda. If you have thoughts.
I have thoughts. I don't know if they're coherent. But just to clarify on something else, I don't absolve, like, countries, Muslim-majority countries, from also objectifying their players. I just wanted to clarify that. Like, I ranted on my blog not too long ago. No, of course not. You didn't. But I'm just saying I don't want people to think I'm advocating for sexist media in Pakistan, because it can be terrible. Like, men are sexist all over the world. Like, it's consistent. Can be misogynistic in their reporting everywhere. Misogyny doesn't discriminate. So in terms of nationalistic agendas, I mean, women can often be used as props politically, but I mean, I don't know enough about each particular place. Ibn Taj Muhammad is a wonderful example of how she speaks for herself and how she was very vocal in identifying herself as a Muslim American in the way she wanted to. And I think social media has a lot to do with that, which is something I forgot to mention in my Prezi. In the age where I said, actually, reading about Muslim women, you have access to their Twitter accounts. There's a really formidable soccer player in Portland. Her name's Nadia Nadim. She's an Afghan refugee. She's a Sweden national. She moved to Sweden as a refugee, and her story is incredible. And she's the best person to advocate because she's like a soccer star now, and her country gave her refuge and gave her support, and that's what happens. And a lot of times, I mean, there's some stories that aren't so great. I wrote a story 4 years ago. It still stuck with me about Samia Yusuf Omar, who was a Somali runner. She died trying to cross the Mediterranean. And she was at the Olympics in 2012, and she died after that. She died 2013. And she just wanted safety and refuge, and we lost an athlete. And it's just sad because of she didn't get support in her home country for what she did aside from her immediate family. And she ran at night so people would identify her. She ran in a male tracksuit. So these stories exist, and they're really, really difficult. But given they're a way to tell. And then when she did go to the Olympics, immediately the Somali government were like, hey, look how much we support women. We sent one. Nah, bro. You know what I mean? So I'm a bit cynical sometimes. But then there's some really great stories of people like, you know, doing really incredible things all over the world. And I get to see that and I get to hear about it. So find those stories. Yeah.
So are Muslim women any more vulnerable or prone to violence in sports than other women?
All women are prone to violence in sports. Like, oh, sexism, misogyny is just, like, I think they're prone to gendered Islamophobia, which is misogyny and xenophobia and racism all layered. So gendered Islamophobia is very specific attacks on Muslim women, and it's a combination of all those things. And I don't know if they're more prone, but I mean, I just see so much of it, sexualized violence in sport against women, misogyny generally, I wouldn't be able to comment that it's more. I think it's so awful and widespread, and we need to shut it down, like, immediately. Like yesterday, so just like, for example, I'm completely in love with Serena Williams, as I'm sure everybody in this room is. But she went through a really hard time and was given a brutal time by sports reporters. I don't know if anybody has seen this clip of her that came out recently at the US Open, which she just won. It's of a reporter saying, well, that was a really scrappy performance. And Serena and all of her glory is sitting there posed. And she went, oh, that's not very nice. That was a nice thing to say. I think you should apologize for that. And he apologized. And I'm just sitting there almost weeping because she's so amazing. And, like, that's what needs to happen. It's a combination of women all over the place showing solidarity and support for each other. Like, for example, the FIBA hijab ban. We haven't seen any WNBA stars actually speak about it. LeBron's the only one that gave a nod to Bilkis on Twitter. Why have we not seen that? I'm not going to fault women of color for not standing up because they're the most marginalized out there. But it would be lovely to, and neither do the women, the Muslim women basketball players that I asked. They're like, we don't expect other women to stand up for us because it's always those women doing the work. It's always women of color doing the work. Like standing at the front lines doing this, it's always women doing the work. And it's about time for men to show that solidarity. I wrote a piece recently for the Shadow League about LeBron James being on the cover of Sports Illustrated with a big safety pin. And I don't know if anyone understands the symbolism of the safety pin, but it was used. And there was a lot of criticism of the safety pin. I'm not going to get into a debate about the safety pin. What it was showing solidarity for Muslims around the world. It started in Europe. Just show that you're a supporter of that person. And if you see that person experiencing violence or hatred or Islamophobia, you would be somebody. LeBron didn't have to do that. And LeBron got the biggest ass pin he could get and put on his lapel. Okay, like one of those kilt pins. Because, like, it's LeBron James, right? So he was just going to have a little dinky pin. He had a big pin. Nobody asked him to do that. And as a black man from a marginalized community, a community where it's the most targeted in terms of violence, systemic violence in the United States, for him to stand up and do that meant a lot to me. It meant a lot to me to see that symbolism, that there's a superstar out there using his platform to support a community that's being targeted. So these things matter a lot. And women, it mattered to women. It mattered to Muslim athletes. He gave a nod to Bilkis. That was amazing. Like, I would love to see more. I'd love to see, you know, other than, you know, I love Greg Popovich and Steve Kerr, but to see more people talk about it. That would be great. Yes? Oh, totally. I love that question. I think that it depends on who it is. Ultimately, we have to support the choice of the woman. Because as a black, identifiable Muslim woman, she's also, this is her livelihood. So do we expect people to stand up when they could potentially lose their money? And this is something the basketball player said to me, was that we don't expect women to stand up when they could be fined for doing so, because this is their livelihood and there's a recognition that they need to eat. So you can't ask people that are already out on a limb to keep going out on a limb. However, Ibtihaj has used herself and her platform beautifully and done so. She's also very supported by her sports association. But the other thing is, Ibtihaj didn't come from a sport where her hijab was banned. I mean, they're all covered, all of them. This is why I'm trying to get Muslim women to play hockey. They're all covered anyway, just all of you play hockey. So, the thing is that she, like, she's facing a different situation than basketball players are, because they're also facing that gendered Islamophobia, but they have another challenge. They don't even have access to play their sport. So Ibtihaj has the opportunity to go, and she could represent, you know, the country, and she's there. She has that platform. So a lot of people have expectations of her, but I'm like, you don't put more pressure on her. She's already a tremendous, tremendous amount of pressure she's under. Because not only does she, because remember, she's an athlete first. Training, committing, practice, and now she has to be an activist. So I've always been of the belief, and a lot of people really disagree with me about this. A friend of mine, he used to play for the Wizards. His name is Eitan Thomas. He's really great. We got into a big debate about this. Because he thinks that people should use their platform in order to amplify. But I don't necessarily feel that way, especially when it comes to women. I don't want to burden them further. If they can, support the best we can. Do you know what I'm saying? That's my opinion, though.
All right, one last opportunity to thank our speaker, Shireen Ahmed, for coming.